University. They have just made the introductions of the teams. The water polo game tonight for the gold medal between the United States of America and Yugoslavia. The gold medal this country of the United States has not won in over 80 years. It's a cool night in Malibu. The temperature tonight, 65 degrees. Hello, everybody. I'm Tim Brandt, along with Jim Cruz, a former member of the national team. And Cruiser, when you look at these two teams, what do you expect tonight?
Classic.
Definitely contrasting styles.
Classic confrontation. The big Yugoslavian team. They like to hold. They like to grab. Biggest team in the tournament, physically strong, versus the United States. They like to run with the ball. They counterattack like a school of scared minnows out there as soon as they get it. Classic confrontation.
It has not been an easy way for this United States team. They've had to battle all the way. Let's go back now and relive the last 9 days of this tournament. 9 days that could make up for the lack of 80 years that it's taken this country to get in this position to win the gold medal. The United States water polo team entered the 23rd Olympiad as the favorite to win the gold. But the pressures of playing at home caused anxiety. It took a late game explosion and 3 goals from this guy, number 6, Joe Vargas, to beat the Greeks. The American team was 1-0 with Brazil up next. After trailing early, again came the explosion late. Number 2, Kevin Robertson, scored 3 times. And with a 10-4 win, the United States was unbeaten after 2 games. The third day of water polo competition brought on Manuel Estiarte, number 5 in blue. He plays for Spain and is to this sport what Gretzky is to hockey. There were 3 American players ejected trying to guard the great one. But Estiarte still scored 4 goals and wound up the tournament's leading scorer. The United States kept the pressure on. Kevin Robertson scored 3 times for the U.S., and the Americans beat Spain 10-8. Because of the boycott, this club has been waiting for the Olympics for 7 years, and Kevin Robertson tells why.
For water polo, the last thing, or the highest level you can achieve, is winning the gold medal. I mean, there's nothing after that. And that's, I think, why these guys are still playing.
The 3-0 record gave the United States one of the top positions in the medal round. As play intensified, so did the American offense. Drew McDonald scored against the Dutch to start things quickly. But again, as had been the formula, the United States fell behind. Tony Bunk of the Netherlands scored 5 goals to keep the Holland hopes high. The 4-time Olympian served notice, the Dutch came to play. U.S. team captain Terry Schroeder came back to life and seemed to snuff those hopes with 3 goals of his own, and the Americans led in the third quarter. But the United States was shut out for the final 9.5 minutes of the game. Holland had a chance to tie, but Craig Wilson, the United States netminder, made 2 critical saves in the closing seconds. He could be the best goalie in the world and says he thrives on all this pressure.
I hate to lose. I like to, before a game, I like to say to myself, if we lose this game, it's going to be my fault. And when I put that kind of pressure on myself, it makes me play better.
The surprise team of the Olympic tournament had been Australia, but the Aussies found themselves down under quickly against the United States as Terry Schroeder went to work again. Head coach Monty Nitzkowski's self-imposed pressure had been somewhat alleviated. The high point was the play of Jody Campbell, who shares the low post with Schroeder. Jody scored 3 goals and illustrated the superb depth of the red, white, and blue. Campbell, number 11, has picked up the pace with his quick reflexes and accurate shots. Against the Federal Republic of Germany, the United States found themselves tied in the last minute of play. But watch the German goalie. He comes out of the net. In a rare and controversial call, he's whistled for interference and ejected. Peter Rolle then had to watch one of his teammates take over the goal position, a regular field player trying to guard the German net. Doug Burke scored almost immediately for the U.S., and the Americans led 8-7. But West Germany had time to come set up the offense with one last chance to tie. This was easily becoming the tournament's most exciting game.
6 seconds, 5 seconds, West Germany, it hits the crossbar, 1 second, that's the end of the game!
The celebration began for the Americans, but for the Germans, the disappointment showed. Take another look. The play had been set up perfectly for the Germans. The pass, the open net. The United States remained unbeaten by the width of a crossbar. It's been 7 years of sacrifice. The long days of preparation and pain were now paying off for the gold.
When I really sit back and really analyze, you know, everything and weigh all the positives against all the negatives, there's so many more positive things that really make me keep going and make, I think, all of us on the team keep going. And at the end of that road is the gold medal waiting for us, and the opportunity to be the best team in the world if we can't win that gold medal, then we sure are going to give it our best, and we're going to have fun doing it along the way.
They are packed four deep on the outside of the stadium. There is a record crowd here within the ticket area, an estimated crowd of some 6,000 people. The teams now are in the pool, going through their last-minute preparations, just trying to stay loose. It is a cool night here at Pepperdine University in Malibu. A cool breeze blowing off the ocean. Temperature now about 60 degrees. The swim for the gold, you can feel the tension. The United States, it's been 80 years in this position. Yugoslavia, very strong team, and they are favored.
Finished here yet, but we might start looking forward to tomorrow, because what a day it's going to be. Carl Lewis going for his fourth gold medal in the 4x100 relay, the men's 1500 meter final, that all-star cast with Sebastian Coe and Steve Ovette of Britain, Steve Pram, the world record holder, and of course Steve Scott of the United States. The men's volleyball game, the final for the gold medal, the United States may finally get that one going against Brazil, but remember, Brazil beat them in three straight games earlier this week. Boxing finals, 10 Americans will be going into the finals for gold medals in the 12 divisions. And men's platform diving, that'll be the prelims with the finals on Sunday. Greg Louganis should be the star of that. So there's an awful lot going on here. We mentioned earlier that the United States women's field hockey team won a bronze medal, the first ever won by the American women in that sport. They finally had to do it on a basis of penalty shots. Both they and Australia, the team with which they are tied, were the same in wins and losses and goal differentials and all the usual tiebreakers. They finally had to just come out, take a series of penalty shots, and the United States won it and won the bronze medal. Now, we said we hope to have a word from Mary Decker on exactly what happened in that race, the real tragedy that befell her. Here's the story.
Zola Budd tried to cut in without being basically ahead, and I think her foot caught me, and to avoid pushing her, I fell. I mean, when I think about it now, I should have pushed her, but if I had pushed her, tomorrow the headlines would have read Decker shoved Zola. And, you know, there wasn't anything I can do. And when I did fall, I tried to react and tried to get up, but when I tried to twist, that's when I felt my hip. That's when I felt, you know, the muscle problem. I don't think there's any question that she was in the wrong. And give it be that it's inexperience on her part, but she was not in front. You have to be at least a full stride ahead before you cut in on someone. And she was cutting in around the turn, and she wasn't anywhere near passing. And I do hold her responsible for what happened, because I don't feel that I did anything wrong. As a matter of fact, I was running a good race, a good pace, and I felt really good, and I am fit. And hopefully the injury will heal in time so I can go over to Europe and race.
And as for Zola Budd, as she's carried off there by her fiancé, Mr. Slanes from Great Britain, the discus thrower, that was Mary Decker, obviously, but I was starting to say before I noticed Mr. Slanes there that as for Zola Budd, she was at first disqualified from seventh place where she finished, but later was reinstated in seventh place with no further explanation so far. So what a strange, unusual, wild, and really exciting night it has been here again in Los Angeles. A half an hour from now, our late night coverage with Jim Lampley and Donna DeVerona. That'll be live coverage of the water polo game, the United States against Yugoslavia for the gold medal. Tomorrow we start at 11:30 a.m., 11:30 Eastern Daylight Time. It's Saturday, of course, slightly different schedule, but ours will be the same on prime time, 7 o'clock until midnight and late night coverage. I'm Jim McKay. So long.
Pepperdine University, a beautiful sight in the night here in Malibu, California. We're at poolside where they're playing for the gold medal. The United States leads Yugoslavia 5-3. Yugoslavia has just scored. Here is Goran Sutno. He's from Dubrovnik, brought it down, double pump, and bounced it past the goalie, Greg Wilson. Greg Wilson, 11 saves on the night, has been playing a spectacular game, but that one skipped right by him. Quite a story developing here. The United States and the Whitecaps, with the ball now in offense, have not won a gold in 80 years. None of these players in the pool have even participated in an Olympic game. They were denied a chance in 1980. They all came back together, and here they are now with their chance for unprecedented history to win the gold in the United States. Tim Brandt and Jim Crews.
Terry Schroeder's commanding that two-meter position there. He's been dominating it all night, and that's one of the reasons the United States has been able to come out to this early lead. They haven't done that early on in this tournament, and now Terry is starting to drive and hold that position there very well.
Poor shot from outside, the left-hander, Kevin Robertson for the United States, but he had to let it fly. There is a 35-second shot clock in this sport. He was down to two, so he had to take a shot from way outside. The United States was down 1-0, or 1-1 rather. It was tied at the end of the first quarter. Then they were down 2-1, but then exploded with goals from Schroeder, Robertson, Joe Vargas, and now it's a 5-3 game.
Look at him bumping underwater there, Tim. That's the two-meter position. That's the position that is likened to a center in basketball. The ball goes in there, and that's where everything runs from. Everything comes off that position in this sport.
There's Craig Wilson, the goalie. 13 saves now. He throws the outlet pass like a center in basketball does. He says he likes to think of himself as Kareem Jabbar throwing it out to Worthy or Magic Johnson. This is Tim Shaw on the left side now. Gets it up to Joe Vargas. Vargas shot. Milorad Krivokovic, the Yugoslavian goalie. Great big guy in there at 6'2", 190. He's from Belgrade, and he's got great reflexes. Now, it looks like these guys can walk in the bottom of the pool, but you see the depth there. It ranges anywhere from 7 feet to 14 feet. And these guys will swim up to 2 miles in a game.
Now, Yugoslavia is going back into their front court offense, and there's that two-meter man. He's going to be sitting in there holding onto the ball, and a lot of fouls occur there. Fouling is a big part of this game, but when you hear the whistles, that does not stop play. Play begins, and these players react and drive off of all of those whistles.
That can be confusing now. An ordinary foul just splashing. A major foul, like Jim said, is when you go after the man instead of the ball, and you can see the battle raging there. We've got a good old-fashioned Donnybrook going here at Pepperdine. Drew McDonald, for that effort of the United States, is now thrown out of the game for 45 seconds. So he'll sit in the penalty box, and now it'll be a 6-on-5 power play for Yugoslavia. Just like in hockey, they'll move it around.
Yugoslavia is going to get in the game. They needed to score that goal right away, Tim, and they wasted it. They took it.
So that's the end of the third quarter, with the United States still on top, 5-3, with Yugoslavia getting awfully strong, and we'll be back after this.
The games of the 23rd Olympiad are being brought to you by 7-Eleven, giving great athletes the freedom to pursue their dreams. Your hometown Pizza Hut restaurant, home of Pan Pizza. And United Airlines. United is the official airline of the 1984 Olympic Games.
You know, one of the best things about being an ex-big leaguer is getting freebies to the game. Call the front office, bingo. And once these fans recognize me, I probably won't even have to pay for my light beer from Miller.
Down it, crack!
I love them. These fans know I drink light because it's less filling and it tastes great. Good seats, huh?
You're in the wrong seat, buddy. Come on.
Oh, I must be in the front row.
Come on.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer and less.
Good seats, hey, buddy? He missed the tag! He missed the tag!
No matter what unexpected problem should arise, Transamerica Property, Casualty, and Life Insurance can be there to protect you.
Hey, you big ape! Who's gonna pay for this mess?
Transamerica. Insurance, finance, manufacturing.